Lullaby Course number 18, A Course in Miracles, Original Edition, Chapter 7, Section 7, Paragraph 62. When you believe what God doesn't know, then your thought system seems to contradict God's. And that makes it appear as if you are attacking God. We have repeatedly emphasized that the ego does believe that it can attack God and tries to persuade you that you have attacked God. But if the mind cannot attack, then the ego proceeds perfectly logically to the position that you cannot be mind. And by not seeing you as you are, the ego can see itself as it wants to be. Aware of the ego's weakness, the ego wants your allegiance, but not as you really are. The ego just wants to engage your mind in its own delusional system. And the reason the ego wants to engage your mind in its own delusional system is because if it didn't engage your mind in its own delusional system, then the light of your understanding would dispel the ego. The ego wants no part of truth because the truth is that the ego is not true. If truth is total, then the untrue cannot exist. And so that's why commitment to either love or the ego, truth or the ego, must be total, since truth and the ego cannot coexist in your minds without splitting your minds. If truth and the ego cannot coexist in peace, and if you want peace, then you've got to give up the idea of conflict entirely, which means for all time. Now, giving up the idea of conflict entirely and for all time, this requires vigilance only as long as you do not recognize what is true. Vigilance is only required as long as you don't recognize what is true. While you believe that two totally contradictory thought systems share truth, then your need for vigilance is obvious. Your minds are dividing their allegiance between two realities, two creations, and you are totally committed to neither. Now, your identification with reality, that's totally beyond question, except by you, when you are thinking insanely. What you are is not established by your perception, and what you are is not influenced by your perception at all. And so all perceived problems in identification at any level are not problems of fact. They're just problems of understanding, since they mean that you believe what you can understand is up to you to decide. A problem of understanding is you believing that you can understand, that what you can understand is up to you to decide. Now, of course, the ego believes that totally, that what you are is up to you to decide. The ego believes totally that what is true and who you are and what you are is up to you to decide and is influenced by what you think. Of course, the ego is fully committed to that perception. But it's not true. And so the ego, therefore, is totally committed to untruth, which means the ego perceives in total contradiction to the loving right mind and to the knowledge of God. Now you can be perceived with meaning only by the loving right mind. Because your being is the knowledge of God. Any belief that you accept which is apart from what God knows to be true is going to hide God's voice in you and will therefore obscure God to you. Any belief that you accept that is apart from what God knows is something that is going to hide God's voice in you and will therefore hide God to you. Unless you perceive God's creation truly, then you can't know the Creator. Since God and God's creation are not separate. The oneness of the Creator and the creation is your wholeness. It is your sanity. And the oneness of the Creator and the creation is your limitless power. This limitless power that you have when you know that the Creator and the creation are not separate, that limitless power that comes to you from that, that's God's will to you. Because that limitless power is what you are. So if you dissociate your mind from this limitless power, which comes from this knowledge, that Creator and creation are one, then you're going to be perceiving the most powerful force in the universe as if it were weak. And you'll be perceiving the most powerful force in the universe as if it were weak because you don't believe you are part of it. Perceived without your part in this most powerful force in the universe, then God's creation is seen as weak, and those who see themselves as weakened do attack. You don't know that the Creator and the creation are not separate, then you will be seeing the most powerful force in the universe as if it were weak because you don't see yourself as part of that power. And when you don't see yourself as part of that limitless power, then you will see yourself as weak. And when you see yourself as weak, you do attack. Which is the same as saying that you will be making up images, seeing them as unworthy, and attacking them for their unworthiness. Is the same as saying when you see yourself as weak, you do attack. And that is all the world of the ego is. Nothing. It has no meaning. It does not exist. So don't try to understand the world of the ego. Because if you do, you are believing that the world of the ego can be understood. And you're believing that the world of the ego is therefore capable of being appreciated and loved. That would justify the world of the ego. And the world of the ego cannot be justified. You can't make the meaningless meaningful. Of course, that can only be an insane attempt. Insanity to enter your minds means that you have not judged sanity as wholly desirable. Have Have you allowed insanity to enter your mind? Just means that you didn't judge sanity as wholly desirable. Why did you not judge sanity as wholly desirable? If you want something else besides sanity, then you will make something else. But because it is something else, then what you've made up will attack your thought system, which means divide your allegiance. Now, when your allegiance is divided, because your mind is split between truth and ego, sanity and insanity, then you cannot create in this divided state. You cannot create in a split mind state. And so, you must be vigilant against this divided state. Because only peace can be extended. Your split minds and your split allegiance between sanity and insanity, truth and the ego, is blocking the extension of love's creation. But its extension is your only joy. That is your joy. Extending creation is your joy. But when your mind is split between two allegiances, ego and truth, sanity and insanity, you cannot extend creation, which is your joy. You cannot create. If you don't extend reality, then you're not thinking with your creator, which means you're not creating as your creator created. In this depressing state where your mind is split and you are experiencing a divided state in your mind where you're not creating because you're not extending, in this depressing state, your loving right mind reminds you gently that you are sad because you are not fulfilling your function as co-creator or co-extender with God, which means you're depriving yourselves of joy. And that is what your loving right mind reminds you of gently. You being sad and depressed because you are not fulfilling your function as co-extender of creation, that's not God's will for you. That's your will for you. And if your will is out of accord with God's will, then you're willing without meaning. Yet because God's will is unchangeable, then no real conflict of will is possible. And that no real conflict of will is possible, that is your loving right mind's perfectly consistent teaching. There's no will but God's. All I really want is God's will, which is that I be a co-creator or a co-extender of creation with God, that I fulfill my function as an extender of creation. That's the only will there is. That's God's will. And everything else is my dream. My allowing insanity to enter into my mind. Creation, not separation. Creation, not conflict, is my will. Because creation is God's will, and nothing that opposes God's will means anything at all. Being a perfect accomplishment. The family of God can only accomplish perfectly, which means extending joy, the joy in which creation was created, and identifying itself with both its creator and its creations, knowing they are one. Chapter 7, Section 8, The Total Commitment. Whenever you deny a blessing to another, you will feel deprived. This is because denial is as total as love. And that means it is as impossible to deny part of the family of God as it is to love the family of God in part. Nor is it possible to love the family of God totally at times. In other words, you cannot be totally committed sometimes. Remember a very early lesson which said, never underestimate the power of denial? Denial has no power in itself, but you can give denial the power of your mind, whose power is without limit of any kind. If you use the power of your mind to deny reality, then reality is gone for you. That's because reality cannot be partly appreciated, and that is why denying any part of reality means you have lost awareness of all of reality. That is the negative side of the law as it operates in this world. Yet denial is a defense. And since denial is a defense, denial is also capable of being used positively, just as much as denial is capable of being used destructively. Used negatively, denial will be destructive because denial will be used for attack. But in the service of the loving right mind, the law requires you to recognize only part of reality to appreciate all of reality. Mind is too powerful to be subject to exclusion, which means you will never be able to exclude yourself from what you project. So when someone acts insanely, they are offering you an opportunity to bless them. And don't forget, their need for that blessing is your need for that blessing. You need the blessing that you offer them. And there is no way for you to have blessing except by giving blessing to them. This is the law of God, and it has no exceptions. The law of God, which has no exceptions, is what you deny to another, you lack for yourself. Now, that's not because what you deny is lacking. It's just because you have denied it in another, and so you will not know of it, and you will not be aware of it in yourself. And so, every response you make is determined by what you think you are, and what you want to be is what you think you are. Every response you make is determined by what you think you are. And what you want to be is what you think you are. Therefore, what you want to be determines every response you make. do not need God's blessing, since you have that forever. But you do need your blessing. And the reason that you do need your blessing is because the picture that you see of yourselves is deprived, unloving, and very vulnerable. You certainly can't love that image of yourself. But you can very easily escape from this image of yourself, or better, leave it behind. And the way that you can escape this unloving, vulnerable, this unloving and vulnerable and vicious image of yourself, this picture that you see of yourself as deprived, unloving, and very vulnerable, you can escape from this self-concept, or better, you can leave it behind by realizing that you are not there, and that is not you. And the way you can leave this image of yourself as deprived, unloving, and very vulnerable behind is to don't see it in anyone. Don't see that picture in anyone. Because if you see this picture, this unloving, deprived, and very vulnerable picture in anyone, then you have accepted it as you. In other words, all illusions about the family of God are dispelled together, just like they were made together. Your illusions about them is dispelled with your illusions about yourself, because your illusions about them and yourself were made together. So, teach no one that they are what you would not want to be. And that is because your brother and your sister is the mirror in which you will see the image of yourself as long as perception lasts. And perception will last until the family of God knows itself as whole. You made perception, and perception must last as long as you want it. Illusions are investments. False perceptions are investments. Which means false perceptions will last as long as you value them. Values are relative. But values are powerful because values are mental judgments. The only way to dispel a false perception of somebody else is to withdraw all investment from them. And then when you withdraw all investment in that perception, that unloving, deprived, and vulnerable perception of them, then that perception of them and yourself will have no life for you, because you put it out of your mind. And while you include those unloving, vulnerable, and deprived perceptions of them and you, while you include them in your mind, you are giving life to them, except that there's really nothing there to receive your gift. The gift of life is yours to give, because the gift of life was given you. You are unaware of your gift of life that is yours to give, because you're not giving it. But you cannot make nothing live, since nothing cannot be enlivened. Therefore, you are not extending the gift you both have and are and so you don't know your being. If you're not giving the gift of life that was given you to give, then you're not extending the gift that you both have and are, and you will not know your being, and you will experience anxiety and confusion. All confusion comes from not extending life, the gift of life. And since not extending the gift of life that you have and are, and being confused about your identity and your being, since that's not the will of your Creator, since not extending the gift of life that you both have and are is not the will of your Creator, it only just produces confusion and anxiety. You can do nothing apart from your Creator, and you do nothing apart from your Creator. And so keep your Creator's way to remember yourselves. And that means teach your Creator's way, lest you forget yourselves. And that means give only honor to the souls of the living God, and count yourself among them gladly. Give only honor to the souls of the living God, and count yourselves among them gladly. Only honor is a fitting gift for those whom God Himself created worthy of honor and whom God honors. And so give others the appreciation which God accords them always, because they are God's beloved souls in whom He is well pleased. You cannot be apart from them because you are not apart from God. Rest in God's love, and protect your rest by loving. And that means love everything God created of which you are a part, or you cannot learn of God's peace, which means you won't be able to accept God's gift for yourself and as yourself. In other words, you cannot know your own perfection until you have honored all those who were created like you, perfect. One child of God, one soul of God, is the only teacher sufficiently worthy to teach another child of God. One teacher is in all your minds, and this one teacher teaches the same lesson to all. This one teacher in all your minds always teaches the inestimable value, the inestimable worth of every soul of God. And this one teacher who's in all of our minds, who always teaches you the inestimable worth of every soul of God, this teacher teaches this lesson with infinite patience. Infinite patience born of the infinite love for which this teacher, this one teacher, speaks. And that every attack is a call for the patience of this one teacher in our minds, because only this one teacher's patience can translate attack into blessing. Only this one teacher's patience can translate attack into blessing. Those who attack, they don't know they are blessed. Those who attack, attack because they believe they are deprived. And so give of your abundance, which means teach others their abundance. And that means don't share their delusions of scarcity, or you will see yourself as lacking. Attack could never promote attack unless you perceived attack as a means of depriving you of something that you want. Yet you cannot lose anything unless you didn't value it and therefore didn't want it. And when you don't value something, you don't want it, and so it seems to go away. Feel that you have lost it. That makes you feel deprived of it. When you don't want something and you don't value it, and it goes away, you tell yourself you've been deprived of it, and then you project your own rejection. In other words, you will believe that others have taken it from you. One must be fearful if he believes that others are attacking them to tear peace and love from them. You've got to be fearful if you believe that others are attacking you to tear your peace from you. And believing that someone else is attacking me to tear my abundance and my peace from me, this is the ultimate basis of all of the ego's projection. Being the part of your mind which does not believe it's responsible for itself. And being without allegiance to God, the ego is incapable of trust. The ego is incapable of trust. Why? Because the ego is the part of your mind which does not believe it is responsible for itself. And the ego is without allegiance to God. And that's why the ego is incapable of trust. Projecting its insane belief that you have been treacherous to your creator, the ego believes that others who are as incapable of being treacherous to them and God as you are out to take God from you. Projecting the ego's insane belief that you have been treacherous to your creator, the ego believes that others are out to take peace and love from you. Whenever anybody attacks another, this is exactly what they believe. And that's because projection always sees your wishes in others. Projection always sees your will, what you have done, what you want in others as if they are doing it to you. Projection always sees what I have done as if it is being done to me. What is it that I perceive is being done to me? That is what I believe I have done to others and to God. In other words, If you will to separate yourself from God, then that is what you think others are doing to you. You are the will of God. Do not accept anything else as your will, or you are denying what you are. If you deny what you are, which is everything that's been created, if you deny what you are, you will attack, believing you have been attacked. But if you see the love of God in yourself, then you will see the love and the abundance of God everywhere, because the love and the abundance of God is everywhere. So see God's abundance in everyone, and you will know that you are in God with them. They are part of you, as you are part of God. You are as lonely without understanding this as God Himself is lonely when God's souls do not know Him. The peace of God is understanding this. There is only one way out of the world's thinking, just as there was only one way into the world's thinking. And the only way out of the world's thinking is to understand totally by understanding totality. Which means perceive any part of the ego's thought system as wholly insane, wholly delusional, and wholly undesirable. And you have correctly evaluated all of it, all of the ego's thought system. Correctly evaluating all of the ego's thought system, this correction enables you to perceive any part of creation as wholly real, wholly perfect, and wholly desirable. Wanting this only, you will have this only, and giving this only, you will be only this. The gifts you offer to the ego are always experienced as sacrifices, but the gifts you offer to creation are gifts to you. The gifts that you offer to creation, every time you give the gift of life, the gift of love that you are. These gifts will always be treasured by God because they belong to God's beloved souls who belong to Him. All power and glory are yours because the creation is God's.